Good morning, colleagues. It's a great pleasure for me this morning to introduce Yuri Matiyasevich, who has been visiting us as a PIMS fellow, and he's going to give a lecture on Hilbert's 10th problem as it exists today. So, please.
First of all, I wish to express my gratitude to PIMS for inviting me to give this meeting on Hilbert's 10th problem. I will begin with the history of the problem. It was almost exactly 100 years ago in Paris in 1900. At that time, mathematicians get together in Paris for the Second International Congress of Mathematicians. And one of the invited speakers was David Hilbert, and he decided that it's good time to outline some open mathematical problems, which passing 19th century was leading to the pending 20th century. And today we know that some of these problems remained open and it should be solved in 21st, 22nd, and so on centuries. There were altogether 23 problems, but in fact many of them are collections of related problems. And the section devoted to the 10th problem was very short, and I can show it completely in both German original and English translation. Determination of the solvability of a Diophantine equation. Given the Diophantine equation with any number of unknown quantities and with rational integral numerical coefficients, to devise a process according to which it can be determined by a finite number of operations whether the equation is solvable in rational integers. First, I need to remind what are Diophantine equations. Syntactically, they are very simple things. These are just polynomial with integer coefficients. And Hilbert asked about solving such equations in rational integers. I will be saying just integers. Hilbert had in mind nothing else but ordinary integers, 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2. And at the very end, I will touch the question of solving equations in algebraic integers. But for most part, I will use just integers for traditional rational integers. And these equations are named after Greek mathematician Diophantus, who lived in the 3rd century after Christ. The novelty which he introduced in solving equations was as follows. Before him, the tradition was to solve equations in geometrical way. For example, the equation x squared equal to 2 was solved by diagonal of a cube with unit side. But Diophantus was interested in solving equations in rational numbers, and for him, this equation, x squared equal to 2, had no solution at all. So a lot of time passed since Diophantus' time, and why Hilbert considered that solving Diophantine equations was still an open problem in 1900. It turned out that number theorists have found solutions of many, many particular Diophantine equations and proved that many others don't have solutions at all. But for different families of equations, or sometimes for particular equations, they had to invent special methods. And so what Hilbert asked in his 10th problem was to find a universal method which would be applicable to any Diophantine equation. In today's terminology, we can consider the 10th problem as a decision problem, which means that it consists of infinitely many individual subproblems, each of which require an answer yes or no. Yes, this equation has a solution, or no, this equation has no solutions. And the essence of a decision problem is the demand that we need to find a single universal method which would be applicable in every particular case. And in fact, the 10th problem is the only decision problem among the 23 decisions, among the 23 Hilbert's problem. So in fact, it could be considered as a problem in computer science which did not exist at that time. And today we know that the 10th problem has no solution. It is undecidable, it's a decision problem. There is no algorithm which, for given arbitrary definite equation, would tell us whether the equation has a solution or not. And in this sense, one speaks about the negative solution of Hilbert's 10th problem. But if you look back at the statement of the problem, you will see that Hilbert even did not mention the word algorithm in the statement. And he used some vague wording, a process according to which it can be determined by a finite number of operations. Why he did not use the word algorithm? He could use it, but it wouldn't help much. Because at the time when the problems were posed, there was no general mathematical definition of an algorithm. There were no particular examples, for example, Euclid algorithm for finding greatest common divisor. There was an intuitive idea what an algorithm is in general, but there was no strict definition. Does it imply that Hilbert posed this tense problem in a bad way? Not at all. Hilbert was an optimist in mathematics, and most likely he expected a positive solution of the problem. But if somebody would invent such a process, then it would be more or less clear that it does the job, that it always gives the correct answer. But the situation is rather different if there is no algorithm, as it turned out the case with Hilbert's problem. Then we need a definition even to state explicitly what it means that the problem has no solution. And the notion of algorithm was strictly defined much later in the 30s of 20th century in the works of Gödel, George, Kleene, Turing, Post, and other logicians. And when this definition was given, it became possible to prove that some decision problems are undecidable. And in fact, the first problems were shown to be undecidable very soon after the algorithm was defined strictly. But these first examples of undecidable decision problems were from logic, and they, so to say, not touch mathematicians. And in 1947, the first problem which arose in mathematics was shown to be undecidable, so-called the God problem for finitely defined semigroups, which is also known as Tuer problem because it was stated by Tuer in 1914. It was done by two mathematicians independently, Markov in Soviet Union and Emil Post in the States. And in one of his papers, Emil Post wrote that Hilbert's 10th problem is begging for the undecidability proof. And these words inspired his student Martin Davis to try to prove the undecidability of Hilbert's 10th problem also. And very soon he came to a conjecture which would immediately imply the undecidability of Hilbert's 10th problem. But before I state his conjecture, I need to introduce more terminology and first to reformulate the 10th problem in a bit different way. Hilbert asked about solving equations in integers. But we can consider a similar problem for solving equations in natural numbers. And by natural numbers, I will understand numbers 0, 1, 2, and so on, including 0 into natural numbers as it is tradition in mathematical logic. So if we have some equation and want to solve it in integers, we can consider another equation with twice as many unknowns. And the second equation has a solution in natural numbers, if and only if the original equation has a solution in integers. So we can say that we reduced solving this equation in integers to solving another equation in natural numbers. And we can say also that the whole decision problem of recognizing solvability of equations in integers reduces to the similar decision problem for recognizing solvability of equations in natural numbers. But in fact, these two problems are equivalent. There is a reduction in the other direction. If you want to solve some equation in natural numbers, we can consider another equation with four times more unknowns. And this equation has a solution in integers, if and only if this equation has a solution in natural numbers, because by Lagrange theorem, every natural number is a sum of four squares. So these two decision problems are equivalent in the sense that they are reducible one to another. And from technical point of view, it is more convenient to work with natural number unknowns. And from now on, I will suppose that our unknowns are natural numbers, not integers. This is just minor technical deviation. Hilbert asked about solving equations with integer coefficients. But we can also consider equations with symbolic coefficients. Namely, we can consider families of Diophantine equations, which are just, again, polynomial with integer coefficients, which we want to make equal to zero. But we split the variables of the polynomial into two groups, the parameters and the unknowns. And for some particular choice of the values of the parameters, the equation can have solutions in the rest of unknowns. For other choices, it could have no solutions. And we can consider the set of all n tuples of the values of the parameters for which the equation has a solution. Sets having such representations are called Diophantine, and this equivalence is called the Diophantine representation of correspondent set. And sometimes we can say, by abuse of language, that the equation itself is a representation of the set. Here are some simple examples of Diophantine sets. For example, the set of all squares is represented by such equation. The set of all composite numbers represented by this equation, because it implies that A has two factors greater than one. The set of all numbers which are not powers of two is represented by this equation, because it implies that A has a big odd factor. But what if we ask about the complement of this set? In the first case, you would find an equation which defines the set of all numbers which aren't squares. It's not evident, but not very difficult. But the question whether the set of all prime numbers or the set of all powers of two, whether these sets are Diophantine or not, turned out to be more difficult. And the answer was not evident at all. So Martin Davis wanted to give a general characterization of the whole class of Diophantine sets. And there was a one evident necessary condition for a set to be Diophantine. Namely, suppose that we are given some parametric Diophantine equation. Then we can effectively list all n tuples from the set represented by this equation. Namely, we need just to take one by one in some order all n plus m tuples of possible values of all the variables and check whether the equality holds or not. As soon as we have the equality, we will just put this n tuple on some special list. And in this way, on this list, we will put only the elements of the set, and every n tuple from this set will sooner or later appear on this list, and maybe many times. So this was a very special process for generating a list of all elements of our set. But we can consider an arbitrary algorithm for doing it. And in this way, we came to a very important notion, compatibility theory. A set of n-tuples of natural numbers is called listable or effectively enumerable if there is an algorithm which would print in some order, possibly with repetitions, all elements of this set M. And for example, it is evident that the set of all prime numbers is listable, or the set of all powers of 2 is listable. It's easy to write corresponding programs in any language. So we see that every Diophantine set is listable. This is a necessary condition. And Martin Davis conjectured at the beginning of the 50s that in fact this condition is also sufficient, that the notion of Diophantine set and listable set is in fact the same notion. A set is Diophantine if and only if it is listable. It would be a remarkable theory because it establishes a relationship between two notions with very different origin from number theory and from compatibility theory. And it would give important consequences both in number theory and compatibility theory. So as I told, it was conjectured by Martin Davis at the beginning of the 50s. And in my opinion, it was a rather bold conjecture at that time, because the informal evidence against the conjecture was very, very strong, in my opinion. So you can look at one corollary of the main theorem. It implies that there is a particular polynomial P such that this equation has a solution if and only if A is a prime. This equation is something special because the parameter comes isolated on the right-hand side, but it's not difficult to show that we can always transform an equation to this particular form. And it means that just the set of all non-negative values assumed by this polynomial for non-negative integer values of the parameters is exactly the set of prime numbers. In the beginning of the 50s, it was considered quite unbelievable, and it was one of the arguments against Davis' conjecture. There was another striking corollary of Davis' conjecture. Namely, we can list all listable sets. Formally, we can find one particular set for every n. It would be a set of n plus 1 tuples with the following equivalence. N tuple belongs to K sets if and only if these n plus 1 tuples belong to our universal set. And this set being listable should have, by Davis' conjecture, a Diophantine representation. And it implies that we can obtain a representation for any listable set of n tuples just by fixing the value of one of the variables in one fixed Diophantine equation. So, for example, for one value, we would obtain the set of all prime numbers, for the other value, the set of all powers of 2, and so on. And this result can be stated without the notion of Diophantine or listable set. We can say that this equation is universal in the following sense. If you give me any Diophantine equation with n parameters, we can effectively find particular value Kp such as two equations are solvable for exactly the same values of the parameters. And this equation can have a arbitrary number of unknowns and can be of arbitrary high degree. Well, this equation has fixed number of unknowns and has fixed degree. So I told that Davis posed his conjecture in the beginning of 50s, and soon he made the first step to the proof of his conjecture. He obtained an almost definite representation for every listable set. Namely, he gave representation of this form, which differs from from a genuine Diophantine representation just by one universal quantifier here. And this universal quantifier is limited by the value of preceding existential variable. Such representations became known as Davis normal form, and it was a quantitative improvement over previous results of Kurt Gödel, who showed that we can always find an arithmetical representation, maybe with many universal quantifiers in it. The next important step was done by three authors, Martin Davis, Hilary Putnam, and Julia Robinson, and they published a joint paper in 1961. And in this paper, they were able to eliminate the universal quantifier, but the cost for this elimination was rather high. Namely, they were forced to consider a broader class of equations, so-called exponential Diophantine equations, which are equalities of this form, where E sub L and E sub R are so-called exponential polynomials. They are just traditional expressions constructed from variables, in particular positive integers, by addition, multiplication, and exponentiation. So considering this broader class of equations, they were able to find representation for every listable set. So they proved a weaker form of Davis conjecture. And this result had similar corollaries for the case of exponential Diophantine equations. First of all, we obtained that there is no algorithm for deciding whether an arbitrary exponential Diophantine equation has a solution, because there were no examples of listable sets for which there were no algorithms to decide whether this is an element of the set or it is not. And second, we could obtain an analog of universal exponential Diophantine equation, so that we could reduce solvability of every other equation to solvability of particular case of this equation by fixing the value of one of the parameter. And this was still an unbelievable result, whether this could be transported to the case of Diophantine equations. The following was written by George Kreisel, prominent logician, in his review for Mathematical Reviews. These results are superficially related to Hilbertson's problem on ordinary, it is non-exponential Diophantine equations. The proof of the author's results, though very elegant, does not use recondite facts in the theory of numbers, nor in the theory of recursively numerical sets, and so it is likely that the present result isn't closely connected with Hilbertson's problem. Also, it is not altogether plausible that all ordinary Diophantine problems are uniformly reducible to those in a fixed number of variables of fixed degree, which would be the case if all recursively numerical sets were Diophantine. But Kreisel was not the only who underestimated the work done by Davis, Putnam, and Robinson. When my scientific advisor, Sergei Maslov, introduced me to this problem, I asked him what should I read in advance before trying to tackle the problem. And he said, oh, there were some problems by American mathematicians, there were some papers by American mathematicians, but you do not need to read them. Why? You see, they haven't succeeded so far, so most likely their approach is misleading. And he suggested me to try another approach, which was, so to say, advocated by Markov. This approach was connected with so-called word equations, And it was known that such equations could be reduced easily to Diophantine equations. He just suggested me to prove the anticipability of wet equations. But now we know that this approach was leading nowhere, because in 1977, Makanin proved that there is a decision procedure for wet equations. So luckily, I haven't spent too much time trying to prove anticipability of wet equations. And I finally read these papers by Davis, Putnam, and Robinson, and began to think in their direction. And what remained after their work? Well, what remained it was to show that one particular set of triples of this form is Diophantine. As soon as we have a Diophantine representation for exponentiation, then we could easily transform an arbitrary exponential Diophantine representation into genuine Diophantine representation of the same set. We would just need to use several copies of this equation to eliminate each particular exponentiation in the equation. So, in order to prove that every listable set is Diophantine, it was sufficient to prove that this particular set is Diophantine. And in fact, this problem was studied by Julia Robinson at the beginning of the 50s, at the very same time when Davis posed his conjecture. But the initial approach of Julia Robinson was quite different to that of Davis. It was a question stated by Alfred Tarski, an outstanding logician. He noticed that the set of numbers which are not powers of 2 is Diophantine. And he asked if one could prove that the set of all powers of 2 is not Diophantine. So he believed that this set is not Diophantine at the same time when Davis believed that all listable sets are Diophantine. So this emphasized how bold was the conjecture of Davis at that time. And so Julia Robinson tried for some time to prove that the set of powers of 2 is not Diophantine. Naturally, she failed, and then she switched to trying to prove that the set of powers of 2 or any other number or the general exponentiation is Diophantine. But at that time, she also failed to do it. But nevertheless, she found a sufficient condition for the existence of a Diophantine representation for the set of for exponentiation. She proved that we can find a different representation for this set. As soon as we can find a particular equation, these two parameters, u and v, which would have two following properties. In every solution, we would have the value of one of the parameters not too large compared to the value of the other parameters. On the other hand, for every k, we should have a solution with u sufficiently large compared to v. And Julia Robinson called relations between u and v with these two inequalities relations of exponential growth. And also they became known as Julia Robinson predicates. In fact, this is something roughly exponential, faster than any particular power of u, but not too fast. So, what remained after this work of Julia Robinson? It remained just to look at many, many papers written by number theorists and to find their particular two-parameter equation with these two properties. But striking enough, none of the equations studied since the first time till the 50s of our century, none of the equations had these two properties. Always we either had infinitely many solutions in this condition was violated, or solutions were very small and we cannot satisfy this condition. This work was done in the beginning of the 50s. And after the joint work of Davis, Putnam, and Robertson, which I mentioned, it became clear that the existence of such an equation would imply the Davis conjecture in its full scope, that every set, listable set, is Diophantine. And at some point, Julia Robinson lost his belief in the existence of such equation, and she tried to prove that there is no such an equation. Finally, the last step was done by me in 1970. If there were no such equation with these two properties, one had to construct it artificially. And I was able to do it. I just defined the relation U to B Fibonacci number with the index 2V. And Fibonacci numbers have been studied by centuries. A lot of properties were known about them, but it's rather strange. I was able to find yet another property which seems to be never discovered in number theory. Namely, if one Fibonacci number is divisible by the square of another Fibonacci number, then this number should divide the index of the second number. And this property played an important role in the whole construction. And it was just the last step in the proof of Davis conjecture. And it is now often referred as DPRM theorem after Davis, Putnam, Robinson, and myself. And the whole proof of this theorem was constructive in the sense that as soon as you give a description of a listable set in any standard form, we can always effectively construct a particular polynomial, at least in principle. It might be very big. So in order to give you an impression how involved could be polynomials, I will show you this representation for the set of prime numbers. The set of all prime numbers is exactly the set of all positive values assumed by this polynomial, which was exhibited in the paper of Dr. James Jones from Calgary and his younger colleagues. And this polynomial uses all the 26 letters of Latin alphabet. So this is an unknown O. It is not neither number zero, neither O small notation from analysis. And today it's possible to construct such a polynomial using just 10 unknowns. And there is a striking fact about this polynomial. This polynomial represents only prime numbers, but it is itself the product of two polynomials, k plus 2 and the rest. So, of course, one of the corollaries of the main theorem was the unstability of Hilbertson's problem. And you see that we need to deal with rather complicated equations. And of course, it's natural to see for how to say, simple equations, we would still have the unstability. And it is easy to show that we can reduce always the unstability solvability of an equation to another equation of degree 4. This is an old trick found much earlier. But if you want to bound at the same time the degree and the number of unknowns, the situation is much more difficult. And naturally, here there is a trade-off between the degree and the number of unknowns. And here are the best results known for today. Solving any parametric definite equation can be reduced to solving another definite equation with the same parameters of degree d in m unknowns, where for dm you can select any of these pairs. This result of 9 unknowns was obtained by me, but by some reason I never write this proof. It was done by James Jones, and he published this proof. And also it was he who calculated these intermediate values between these two extreme cases, degree 4 and 9 unknowns. Of course, these are upper bounds. We cannot prove. Most likely, they aren't the best. And for example, with my appearance in Calgary, James Jones began to think again about reducing this number to 9, to 8, maybe. He had new ideas, and maybe he would report soon that he was able to reduce it to 9. Besides the mere antecedibility, there was another interesting application of the main theorem for number theory. Suppose that we have some parametric equation, and somehow we know that for every value of the parameter, there is only finitely many solutions. And this fact can be expressed in different ways. For example, we can say that there is a bound on the number of solutions, or we can say that there is a bound on the size of solutions for some computable functions nu and sigma. And from purely mathematical point of view, these two statements are equivalent. But they are very different from computational point of view. As soon as we have a bound on the size of solutions, then we can, at least in principle, calculate the number of solutions. But if we are given just the bound for the number of solutions, in general, we have no tool to find the bound on the set of solutions. And in fact, in number theory, there are known many classes of equations for which we have the bound on the size, on the number of solutions, but no bounds on the size of solutions. Such proofs are often given by bringing something to contradiction. We suppose that there are many solutions and came contradiction, but it does not produce any bound on the size of solutions. I was able to show that, at least in the theory of exponential definite equations, there might be a deep underlying reason why these two kinds of results are another different in their difficulty. Namely, I was able to construct a particular equation, unfortunately exponential Diophantine equation, with one parameter, which has the following two properties. For every value of the parameter, there is at most one solution in the unknowns. But if you take any function which can be effectively computable for every value of this argument, it's possible to find such a value of the parameter for which the equation would have a solution, but this unique solution would be greater than the value of a function. So you cannot bound it neither by any iteration of exponentiation nor by any computable function. But transporting this result to the case of general definite equation remains still a challenge. Now I wish to return back to the statement of the problem. So what is called negative solution is the statement that there is no algorithm for this problem. But we can ask the following question. Would Hilbert himself recognize it as a solution of his problem? Would he be satisfied what was done with this problem? And I dare to say that Hilbert would be satisfied. And to this, to support my point of view, I would like to show you a long citation from his lecture in the Congress of Paris, where in fact he anticipated that some problems could be solved not in the way we would like to do it. So I hope that you agree that Hilbert would accept it as a solution of his problem. But now I can pose another question. Would Hilbert state his problem in this way if he anticipated its negative solution? And here, I dare to say that no, he would not state it in this way. Why? He asked about solving equations in integers. And we saw that this problem is equivalent to solving equations in natural numbers. But as I mentioned, Diophantus himself was solving equations in rational numbers, more precisely in positive rational numbers, because negative numbers weren't known to him. And other problems of Hilbert are in fact collections of related problems. So why Hilbert did not state it as a separate problem, a problem of solving equations in rational numbers? And the answer is more or less clear. If we have any equation which we want to solve in rational numbers, we can consider another equation which has a solution in natural numbers, even only if this equation has a solution in rational numbers. And we can transform this equation into a genuine Diophantine equation just by multiplying by common denominator. And so when Hilbert asked explicitly only about recognizing solvability of equations in integers, he implicitly asked for a method for solving equations in rational numbers also. So he was an optimist, and he believed that he posed the most difficult problem among a number of related problems, and solution of this most difficult problem would immediately give solutions to other similar problems. But now we got negative answer to the problem as it was stated. What does it imply for the case of solving equations in rational numbers? In fact, nothing. And it is known that solving Diophantine equations in rational numbers is exactly equivalent to solving homogeneous Diophantine equations, which are a very special subclass of all equations. And it's quite possible that there is an algorithm for deciding whether a homogeneous Diophantine equation has a solution. So today, we can understand the tense problem in two senses. In the narrow sense, that's exactly as it was stated by Hilbert. Or in the broader sense, to include here all other problems, solutions of which would easily follow from expected positive solution of the tense problem as it was stated. And in the narrow sense, the problem is closed. We got algorithmic indecidability. But in the broader sense, the problem is still open. And we can consider solving equations in rational numbers as a particular case of Hilbert's tense problem in the broader sense. This is a very important problem, but there was not much progress in this direction. Here is another example of a problem which can be considered as Hilbertson's problem in the broader sense. We could be interested in solving equations in Gaussian integers, that is of numbers of this form, where I is the square root of minus 1. But again, if we want to solve some equation in Gaussian integers, we can introduce additional variables to be rational integers and obtain an equivalent statement about solving an equation in rational integers. Here we can separate real and imaginary parts and combine it into single Diophantine equations with integer coefficients. So positive solution of the tensor problem would imply also an algorithm for solving equations Gaussian integers. Luckily, in this particular case, a reduction in the opposite direction was found by Jan de Neve. And thanks to this reduction, we have then the stability of the finite equations in Gaussian numbers also. After that time, many other cases of rings of algebraic integers were considered and proved. It was proved that analog of Hilbertson's problem for them is also undecidable. But striking enough, the general case of an arbitrary ring of integers from finite extension of rational numbers still remains open. When I spoke about the tensor problem in the broader sense, I used such words as solutions of which would easily follow from expected positive solution of the tensor problem. So the real scope of this broader sense of Hilbertson's problem heavily depends on what we understand by easily follow. And if we understand it in a rather broad sense itself, then we can obtain some rather striking reductions, which I want to show to you now. In the eighth problem, Hilbert included Goldberg's conjecture, which states that every even integer greater than 2 is a sum of 2 prime numbers. This conjecture remains open till now. We can consider the set of counterexamples to Goldberg's conjecture. This is a set of numbers which are greater than 2, which are even, but are not sum of 2 prime numbers. Clearly, for every such number, we can check whether it is, in fact, counterexample. And so we can find a particular polynomial which would represent the set of all counterexamples to Goldberg's conjecture. So it just states that this set is empty, or that this particular equation has no solution. So a positive solution of Hilbertson's problem, as it was stated by Hilbert, would thus allow a principle to find out whether the Goldberg conjecture is true or not. The eighth problem also included another famous hypothesis, the Riemann hypothesis, which also is still open. Originally, it was about the zeros of this analytic function, which is defined by this series in the half plane, but can be extended to the whole plane. But again, we can construct particular Diophantine equation, which has no solution if and only if the Riemann have true. This could be done either on the basis of this definition and a technique of complex variable, or most simple way is to use connection of the hypothesis with the distribution of prime numbers among natural numbers. So again, we see that the positive solution of Hilbertson's problem would give us, in principle, possibility to decide hypothesis is true or not. Hilbert's conjecture and the Riemann hypothesis were problems about numbers. The third example is not about numbers, it's about graphs. The four-color conjecture was a long-standing challenge to mathematicians, and finally it was proved by Eppel and Hackel. But again, without reference to their work, we can construct a particular Diophantine equation which has no solution if and only if the four-color conjecture is true. The four-color conjecture was not included by Hilbert into his list of problems, but it exists in the tenth problem in this guy's form. So we saw that three of the problems, Goldberg's conjecture, the Riemann hypothesis, and the four-color conjecture, can be restated as assertions that particular different equations have no solutions. What use could be made of such reductions? Of course, we cannot hope either to give a new proof to the four-color conjecture or to prove Goldberg's conjecture or the Riemann hypothesis by using any universal method for Diophantine equations because it does not exist. And hardly we can obtain here any by looking at the particular Diophantine equations and trying to do any intelligent work, because these equations would be very, very involved. But we can change the order of things. The first two problems are still open, but the third is now a C. And so we can see that the technique of Eppel and Hackel is a technique for dealing with very particular involution. And now we know that to solve more and more equations, we need to invent more and more special methods. So one could try to understand what the technique of Eppel and Hackel means in terms of equations and try to generalize it to other equations. And also, these reductions could serve as, so to say, psychological explanation why the tenth problem is. We have a formal proof by using the notion of algorithm. But here we can also say that it's very unlikely that so difficult problems from so different areas of mathematics could by a unique method which Hilbert asked to find in his tenth problem. Thank you for attention.
Thank you very much. You said it's been extended to the Gaussian integers, presumably also for the Einstein-Jacobi. Eisenstein-Jacobi integers. Adjoin the cube root of 1 to the integers.
Yes, I told there were many results of this kind. I just don't remember which case.
How far to other quadratic rings of integers?
As I remember, all imaginary distortable, but I'm not sure about real quadratic fields.
No.
There was a good survey by Faders in this area, so you can consult with them.
What are the implications for cryptography?
Well, I saw once a paper where they try to introduce new cryptographic scheme based on the antecedibility of resonance problem, but I'm not sure that it's a practical thing, because we need, on the one hand, difficulty in deciphering and without key, but is a value. I can say that there was another result not directly connected to this work, that is just one equations of the form. Shown that solving even equations of degree 2 into unknowns isn't too hard. So this could be used for cryptography in some way.
Yeah. If there's no connection between the P equals NP problem, what is that?
Well, direct connection, but still there was some connection. Two mathematicians, Adleman and Manders. Adleman, one of the authors of this RSA scheme, they introduced the known machine. It's something very simple. This Diophantine machine is, by the Fermat theorem, as powerful as Turing machine, for example. Every set recognized by the Turing machine can be recognized by such a machine. And the question which was posed by Adleman and Manders was to say how fast this machine is. Here we have, as a measure of complexity, the size of the least possible values for the axis. And they introduced the class D of sets which are defined by such machines. It's polynomial bounds on the sides of the variables. And the question which they asked was this, in fact, NP. But this question remains open. Unfortunately, the present technique requires rather big values. Financial advantage than the time for a Turing machine. There would be some connections with PNP problem if you were able to prove the whole theorem and so-called bounded arithmetic with restrictions on the axiom of induction. But again, no one was so far able to do it.
Another question? Thank you.